I come across of an article about another technique to save human lives. Suspended animation trials to begin on humans. Knife and gunshot wound victims will be placed in suspended animation.
Ah, there it is!
There it is.
Then what?
I was going to continue.
How are they doing it?
The technique...
You mean like a coma?
Hold on. It's like...
Like when they go to outer space to Mars or something, or another galaxy.
It's like, it's based on a... It's based on a... Trying to... It will initially be used on 10 patients who would otherwise be lethal in an attempt to buy surgeons of times. It works as suggested by science fiction by cooling the body but not applying external temperature change. Instead, a team of surgeons will remove all the patient's blood, replace it with a cold saline solution. This will cool the body, slowing its functions to a halt, and reducing the need for oxygen. Effects are similar to those that have been seen in accidents. Swedish Anna fails to survive trapped under a layer of ice freezing water for 80 minutes in a skiing accident. Japanese Mitsusuka is thirsty to survive 24 days without food or water by entering a state of hyperthermia. Survive 24 days without food or water by entering a state of hypothermic hibernation.
Bring a good chair.
Huh. It's like...
And they do this to who?
10 patients who have received a... who happen to be gunshot and stabbing of victims.
Huh.
All control based on a previous experiment when done on pigs. All the control pigs whose body's temperature was left alone died. The pigs who were warmed back up at medium speed demonstrated a 90% survival rate. Although some of their hearts had to be given a jump, the pigs that were warmed up and slow and fast had a 50 and 30% survival rate, respectively. Afterwards, the pigs demonstrated no physical or cognitive impairment. The technique, therefore, will only be used as emergency measures on patients who have suffered cardiac arrest after severe traumatic injury, with chest cavity open and having lost at least half of their blood already.
And so they can be kept suspended for a month?
We don't know.
24 days?
It's not science fiction yet, quite yet. The human body can only be safely placed under these conditions for the maximum of a few hours. But even if it raises the survival rate just a little, it'd be a massive step forward. It is quoted from a CNET.
Hmm. In spite of it, you're quite joyful.
I was born with a sunny smile.
Yeah. No, me too. In spite of my despair, I think I'm pretty joyful.
I had an 8th grade teacher that every day told me to wipe that sickening smile off. Every day. I mean, it left a permanent dent, but it didn't keep me from smiling.
It
left a dent in my smile.
Isn't that what they say? Once they tell you to not do it, then you have to do it.
Yeah.
I hear smiling is good for you. It activates things in your brain and body.
Sure.
Did you watch that TED Talk? I think it was a TED Talk.
No, I didn't.
There's one about smiling. It's really short. You guys should check it out if you want to. But
you know,
laughter even more.
You know the TED Talk?
It's about how smiling. It brings out like a lot of different neurological.
The whole world smiles at you.
It's like I'd rather laugh that is not controlled than to be told to shut up.
Me too.
It's like...
I don't like being told to shut up.
My granddaughter developed a kind of a laughter tic. And her boyfriend. They laugh at the end of every single sentence.
Phoebe?
No matter what, yeah. No matter what, yeah. They'd go like that. Yeah.
Maybe everything's just slightly absurd to them, so they have to laugh at all.
But it's a total habit.
Would you rather them laugh or say like in a sentence all the time?
I I think I'd almost prefer light.
Really?
Yeah, to the laugh. Because it's
yeah, it's easier to ignore probably.
Nervous discharge. It's strange.
And they said singing was good. It cheered up the troops.
Yes.
Yeah, you can't even, at some point if you're faking laughing, almost inevitably you end up sort of really laughing. Even at the absurdity of you trying to fake laughing. You know, I've done that where I have a friend who's really into laugh therapy and he wanted to record just different people laughing. So, you know, I have a little portable studio at my studio, so we recorded him, and he just goes, "Why don't you laugh at me, Manuel?" And I'm like, and I have a pretty boisterous, loud laugh, so I was just pretending, and pretty much after a while, I was laughing so hard, for real, from fake for real, which made me laugh even more, like, wow, who would have discovered that I'd be able to fake my way, you know, the fake it till you make it, kind of, and all of a sudden I was really laughing, which was such a fun surprise, made me laugh even more, and I was almost peed my pants, I was laughing so much.
One time I laughed very hard for a bunch of funny videos, and I coughed, almost ran out of breath.
Yeah. Well, that's the good laugh where people can't even make a noise, right? They just kind of go... Just completely, all they can do is kind of breathe, otherwise they will die laughing.
It's terrible when you get caught in that. I was giving a talk to like a Toastmasters club in college, or it was a fraternity, and I something I said I thought was so funny started to laugh, and I couldn't stop. And then they're all sitting there looking at me, and I am, you know, I mean, you're in a kind of a forced fit, you don't know what to do about it. And you have to kind of, it's like a, it's a corollary to grief seizure. You know, I call it the paroxysm of nature. And so getting in caught in a laughing fit is comparable to that. And you just have to wait till you're over it. Oh, so embarrassing. And you don't even want to be laughing anymore. You just kind of...
You can't will it to stop.
Well, you're observing yourself acting like a complete idiot. The hell is the matter?
Keep it up all you want, oh, trigger it in me.
Yeah.
So to go back to Soylent, is that a kind of a discussion then on the essence of food? In some ways, because they are saying that food is just made up of these minerals, and so if we can just get the essence, which is these minerals for that we need for sustenance, is that, or I don't know, I'm still having a little bit of trouble with distinguishing existence from essence.
We're going into it today,
pal. I know. So I just hope maybe you can shed a little bit of light.
There's probably 20 definitions of essence.
That's what the internet was telling me, that there's no one, that's why I'm kind of lost in all of this, seeing everyone have their own take.
Perfume.
That guy was totally talking about that. He was big on the perfume.
That almost ruined it. But, you know, you got to think form to begin with. See, ideas don't even work. Ideas are essences in Plato's thought. So you'd have to say something like ideational.
Ideational,
they get to the, let's say, structure of ideas. We're so used to saying, well, that's just an idea. Merely, simply, only, but, just, I mean. I told you, I got cued to that at MIT, where students like saying, well, it's only a myth, or it's only a symbol, or it's simply, merely, just. And I practically hit a kid when they'd say, only, simply, merely, just in a sentence. Oh, Aeneas is just a puppet of the gods. So I got real reactive to people that, you know, demeaned or depreciated, debunked something with only simply merely just. They say only an idea, merely an idea, just an idea. And that's the structure of Plato's thought, is what's ideational, namely essential. So it's the premier abstract majesty of thought that is related to what's essential.
So is that why you kind of gave us the background last week the lead up to Socrates, because the abstract is this essence that we can, because existence is before essence, so we existed, but we couldn't abstract the thoughts into conceivable essences.
Yep. So that was Socrates' favorite strategy, was to say, what is it? And then they'd go, like, what are you talking about? Well, you're discussing justice. What is it? In fact, what is it per se, as such? And that becomes a technical phrase in Plato. What is it per se? Namely, in itself, as such. And they'd all look at Socrates like he was crazy, because they had no notion of what anything is in itself, per se. They wanted to quote Homer. Justice is when so-and-so does something to so-and-so. And Socrates saying, no, I don't want an instance, least of all from Homer. I want a definition. How do you define it? So that's the first time definitions come into play as a result of asking questions. And so that's where you get to what's essential. You clear the concepts to get to what's essential. So think of the true, the good, and the beautiful as the premier essences. I told you, John picked it up. They're called transcendentalia in the Middle Ages. It's a fabulous term. What are the most transcendent concepts or ideas in the best sense of the word, or essences formed through the good and the beautiful and the good overall? Would you guys come up here? Because I'm getting to the point where I realize that I've got to hit students to get them to pay attention, so I need them within arm's length.
That's why you want to be close?
Yeah. Do you get that students need to be whipped?
Sometimes.
Or pushed? I got to push their nose to the grindstone?
Come on up here.
Come on up here. You can't get over there. Sit right here next to John.
The table setup just gets weirder and weirder.
Yeah, I know. Closer and closer.
You want to sit here?
She's going to left sitting.
Excuse me. You want to sit here? You should sit at the table. Yeah.
Mary, you're breaking the circle.
Okay.
Don't break the circle.
You can sit over there next to Manuel. My wife and Marta don't count. I'm just kidding.
You help me because we block half the seven.
So we got to break off this essence existence business for a little while, and we'll go back to it. Because today, I am going to overcome your intimidation, which is part of the disciplinary problem. Because you're cowed as a consequence of being in a university environment, and you're intimidated. The whole system of education induces intimidation, and you have to play a deferential role as a student. You really don't feel obliged to speak up a lot. You know, you don't want to interrupt the professor who gets to do all the talking, which is why I like teaching. I like listening to the sound of my voice. And so intimidation and the corollary, a lack of initiative, is a big issue for me. And it's because you're robbed of your self-confidence to the extent that you're intimidated. You know, it's a difference between being timid and being courageous as a student. And it's been such rare instances in my entire teaching career to see students and experienced students who show initiative. You know, like, what else can I do? Can I do something more than what you're, you know, from page what to page what? That's why I started out with this 100 book bullshit. You know, if only one of you would have picked up on that, I would have actually worked with you. Because I start thinking, why can't you think of yourselves as Olympic athletes? Has anybody ever applied an Olympic model to their learning? If you were Olympic athletes, you'd be in intense training every day. Mm-hmm. So why don't you take 10% of an athletic training regimen and apply it to your studies? Well, then you wouldn't boogie. You boogie much?
Boogie.
Yeah. Is it boogieing? Is that the name of the game?
It's the cat's pajamas.
Yeah, I mean, I did. And the fog never lifted for me until, I don't know, after I was out of college. I was in a fog all through college. And I never, you know, I never kind of got what was going on. Because it was, and it was intimidating. I mean, the fog is an expression of the intimidation. It creates a certain atmosphere. And that's because you're unsure of yourself. You know, you don't have the experience to handle what it is you're trying to learn. So anyhow, I brought my thyme spray today for everybody to spray themselves. And this will overcome your mystification by demystifying you. And thyme is the herb of courage. It's the herb of Tumas. Same word as the thymus gland, the gland of courage. And so Nod and I are going to start an herbal company with Joanna Miller and her associate Alice. And we're going to be making this thyme spray to sell in all the college bookstores in the country. It's going to be bigger than the hula hoop.
Bigger than the first time you entered the herbal industry?
Well, with products, yes. I was actually head of the herbal industry for a few years as the executive director of the Herb Trade Association, responsible for organizing the national industry. That's why on my tombstone there will be "Call My Bluff."
It's your bluff?
I didn't know anything. I mean, I backed into it. I didn't have any training in herbal medicine and so on, but you know, I was a quick read. So I picked it all up in a hurry in order to bluff my way through the job. And it was at the beginning, this is in the late 70s, so the industry was just picking up. And they were mostly guys that had peddled dope, you know, they'd all been marijuana, you know, and so they figured, well, let's go into herbs.
And FBI is having trouble hiring hackers who don't smoke marijuana.
Come on up here, Seth.
He wants you within arm distance.
So you can smack me?
Exactly. Have you heard this?
So don't forget, this is a germicidal antiseptic. It's very mild, but it purifies, so it's good for your skin. Your skin really likes moisturizing, which is another reason. These are called hydrosols, and they haven't really hit the market yet. My old colleague, Jean Rose, who was a pioneer herbalist in San Francisco, she's still alive, coined the term hydrosol for these herbal sprays. And it's such an easy way to take in the virtues of herbs. Another one I'm going to do besides the thyme is hawthorn. And hawthorn is, I've got to find out if it's really capable of being used as a spray, you know, without any danger to your skin and whatever. But hawthorn is a major preventive to heart disease. And it's widely used in Germany, and it has as yet to click in this country. Hardly anybody knows anything about hawthorn.
Do you know the etymological roots of hawthorn? Because thyme has a pretty significant, yeah, as you point out.
I don't. In fact, I don't even know the Latin offhand. You want to Google hawthorn and get clear on its Latin?
He's already up.
Okay. Hawthorn?
Hawthorn,
H-A-W-T-H-O-R-N-E. So that's the one regret I had coming out of the herbal industry, which I left in the late 80s, was that we hadn't been able to do anything about hawthorn, even though there was a major monograph in German about its efficacy as a major preventive of heart disease. And the only thing I could think of why it hadn't clicked was because of digitalis, the foxglove plant, which is a major remedy for heart disease, not a preventive. It's a curative, and it's extremely toxic. So it's one of the few medicinal plants that an herbalist probably wouldn't touch, because you have to be so careful about dosage. So then it has to be regulated just right. My father, who was a doctor, remembered grinding digitized leaf with a mortar and a pestle before it became standardized. And so anyhow, I thought, well, maybe it's because of the emphasis on digitalis as a curative, we're so lax in preventive medicine in this country. We don't utilize the botanical basis of healthcare within the health professional field because there's no information system anymore. There's not a course taught in herbal medicine at any major medical, nursing, pharmacy, or nutrition school in the country to this day. And this is, 30 years after I was in the game. And it was clear then, and it's still clear now, which is a big scandal. It's partly because we have a Food and Drug Administration, and there's no middle, realm for medicinal herbs, which are both food and drug. Unlike the Chinese system, where it's totally integrated.
Paul, I don't know if he's going to find in that explanation of the etymology of hawthorn and its herbal properties, I don't know if he's going to find a cultural aspect. It's usually pretty much popular in England, and if not the whole British Isles, because hawthorn was one of the sacred trees
of right.
the Celts.
Yeah.
And in fact,
there's hawthorn herbal remedies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And but I want the Latin binomial for hawthorn.
Just Wikipedia hawthorn.
It'll give you two terms for their genus for the genus and species.
There's Cretoigus.
Yeah, Cretoigus, I guess. Cretoigus.
Correct.
Yeah.
Cretoigus. Commonly called hawthorn, thorn apple, may tree, Whitehorn,
yeah,
Hawberry.
So then you get this kind of legendary, mythical background for a lot of herbs that makes the study so fascinating. So you go back into the tradition when the usage was clear. You go back to the ancient world, and
that's what we're going towards today.
Where? Back to the ancient world.
The movement.
Yeah, and recovering it. So when I had to do a self-instructional manual to teach myself 50 medicinal herbs, their binomials, their properties and uses, to be knowledgeable in the industry, I wanted to know the origins of the herbal tradition in ancient Greece because I was comfortable about that. I taught Greek philosophy and Homer and yada yada for years. And so it just came through almost like a revelatory experience. First herb was the herb of Achilles, Achillea millefolium, which is yarrow. No kidding, yeah. It's a styptic.
That's where you get aspirin from, isn't it?
No, that's willow.
Willow.
So yarrow is a styptic and it stops blood. It coagulates blood. So Achilles used it to apply to his comrade's wounds. And it carries his name, Achillea millefolium. And the next word, herb, these came in right one after another. It was an extraordinary experience. Then came Artemisia, which you have is wormwood, which is Artemisia absinthium, from which they made absinthe. It's got a brain stimulant in it. And if you drank too much of it, it rotted your brain. Toulouse-Lautrec was famous for painting the absinthe drinkers in the late stage of their debilitation. And Artemisia was the Greek goddess, Artemis was the Greek goddess of the woods, the hunt, and the moon. And she was one of the first herbalists. And I got Centauri from Chiron the Centaur. He had an herb school at the foot of his cave at Mount Pelion, and Artemis instructed him. And then and Achilles went to school with him to learn about herbs. There's a legend all about that. And so on. So it was an amazing experience to pick up the old lore around the given herbs that carried their name. And you have St. John's wort, and on and on. So there's a Saliva Marianum. That was one we discovered. It's the milk thistle, and it's called the herb of Mary, Saliva Marianum, because it's reminiscent of the mother's milk in terms of its milky veins. And it's a cure for liver disease. If you get injectables after you've ingested the Amanita phalloides mushroom, you don't die. Otherwise, within 4 or 5 days, you're dead. It's the most virulent mushroom poison known, and Slive Marianum counteracts it. So,
deer urine also does. Huh? Deer urine. The northern shamans, the Siberian shamans, really love Amanita muscaria.
Yeah.
It gives you the feeling that they're flying, and the way they kept from poisoning themselves is the deer. They let the deer really like it. It's a delicacy for the deer, the reindeer. So then they would drink their reindeer the urine.
They drank their own urine if they took it. Because they get it that way again.
Yeah.
Or for anybody else. Get out of here!
Like spray it with stuck some time.
What's going on there?
It's a crow,
isn't it? Conditioning or something.
I think the crow's stuck in the vent.
I think it's in the vent. I saw the vent move.
Yeah.
Seriously?
Did you get it?
So he's been running around in the vent.
I don't know. I saw it move a second ago.
Well, it's been moving too. And he's following the venting because I heard it over there. And it's over here. I don't know how the hell it got in there.
Oh, it is in there.
I think so.
Should we help it?
There must be some university department that takes care of birds.
Yeah, I'll bet. Okay, here we go for the time for. Really? I mean, listen, take in the aroma. And, you know, I made up a notion that there's an ERG code in the immune memory of DNA. I will repeat that, it's one of my best thoughts. There's an ERG code in the immune memory of DNA. So we have a deep memory for herbs. And their scent releases this deep memory. And thyme is one of the best because it was grown all over in public places for people to step on it to release the scent. There's something about the scent of thyme that takes you back to its 2,000-year history. They burned thyme on altars in ancient Greece, and had a chorus that was called the Thyme Illumina, that, you know, it's got a thyme name. And the chorus would dance around the altar as they burned thyme on the altar, and they would get high on the fumes of the burning thyme as incense.
You can get high on the
smoke? I can.
Really?
Yeah, I'm high now.
Do you have to be dancing naked around it? Do you dance naked around it first? Just to
I'm not going that far.
Oh, okay.
So now,
wait, I had a good question about that.
Yeah,
is that in the Americas as well? Does that come over with like exploration or something?
I don't know if it's native or not. That's a good question. Probably not, but I don't know. You know how these things appear in terms of what's indigenous and native as opposed to what was introduced. There was a big exchange of plants in the Renaissance. I mentioned that when they started the botanic gardens in Europe, they sent out plant hunters worldwide because of the opening up of the New World and all the exploration that's going on to find plants of commercial and medicinal value, largely to bring back to these botanic gardens, which always had a section devoted to herbal plants. They were called simples, which is a real neat name. And the art of simpling was the art of herbal practice because they had simple uses. And I don't know enough about all that exchange issue to know. They found tobacco, brought that back to Europe. They found coffee, brought that to Europe. Those made huge impacts on European society when they were first discovered and put to use. So now this is my favorite product because this accomplishes two things. Introducing you to the properties of thyme and your thymus gland. This is a thyme balm to rub on your thymus and to let your thymus know that you love it. It's the center of your self-affirmation. It's your bridge between reason and desire. It's what gives you self-confidence, and it's your centered self because your immune system is based on the distinction between self and not self. I only kind of really got that in talking about this recently. I mean, I always kept them sort of separate without thinking of putting them together, that this is the centered self, okay, and the immune system is predicated on that, namely the distinction between what's self and not self. That's just so extraordinary that that's the language they use. And it's based on the fact that you have a defense system that protects you by knowing who you are. It's all identified as you, and then whenever any foreign entities, germs, microbes, whatever, enter your system is cued to destroy it. And that's the antigen-antibody relationship. And it's like lock and key. It's so specific. It's so brilliantly. I mean, you get overawed at the intricacy and subtlety of the immune system, because every possible germ that could attack you, you've got a defense against it. And it's locked to key. It's called antibody specificity. Ay, ay, ay. You should look at the immune system as an amateur, which is what I did, because it's such an amazing thing to study, and it's so critical to your health. So, we just got this product, and I'm so thrilled with it. And so take a little and start your immune therapy right now. I was thinking it'd be fun to do a time Tiger Balm. Do you guys know Tiger Balm?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Because that would give it the analgesic buzz. You know?
Sounds awesome.
Yeah, it really is amazing. So to get that Tiger Balm buzz with a time basis would be terrific.
It sounds awesome.
I could swear by that. I hurt my hip this week, and I went to my acupuncturist, gave a usual needle treatment. But after that, she rubbed a balm of thyme on it.
No
and
kidding.
It really seemed to work. Huh. Yeah.
For any bruise, you shoot arnica. That's a staple. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of you undoubtedly know that.
Oh my goodness, I think my chest area is getting a vibrant shock out of it.
There he goes. It's taking off. John is getting the Tumas effect.
It's like...
So anyhow, this is so much fun for this to come through after all. I've always regretted not doing any herbal products when I was in the industry and not having any basis in the business side of it, because I didn't have any business aptitude. So to project the possible product line and hope that it might come to fruition, that's terrific.
Paul, where can you buy the thyme balm?
As soon as it gets on the market.
It's not on the market yet?
You can have that one.
I like the way it smells.
Yeah. It's my gift to you.
Thank you.
For asking. Okay, now I want to pick up on the existential business, and we'll do the compost thing later in the hour.
Okay.
We start out to talk about the difference between essence and existence, or at least what is the realm of essence. And it's amazing how little rapport we have with that realm. I mean, you could probably stop anybody on the street and ask them, what does essence mean? And they'd most likely be at a loss. You know, and even if you, you say, well, what about Platonic essences? Well, yeah, what's that about? Well, they're ideas. Oh, just ideas, huh? So that's what happened. It became depreciated and poo-pooed. What's the other word?
Dismissed.
Debunked. And dismissed. It's just an idea. And I told you, that was the great encounter between Goethe and Schiller. Goethe tries to tell Schiller about the Urplant, which for him is the form of all plant forms, and he sees it with his own eyes. And Schiller says, that's just an idea. And it really annoys Goethe that Schiller would say that. And here's Schiller, a poet. I think at least he'd have a poetic rapport with what Goethe is talking about. So I don't know how this came about, that Plato discovers this realm that is known as the essential realm. And it's ingredient for his whole thought. Probably the biggest example of it is the parable of the cave. If you had to pick out one, you know, reasonably short text of all of Plato's dialogue, which is, I mean, first of all, the corpus, the body of his work, at the very point of literacy coming into the culture, is so astonishing. I can never get over it when I think about it. And it was all prompted by the fact of Socrates. He's the one that triggered this whole discovery and response on the part of Plato. So the parable of the cave, you know, is us watching TV in our TV rooms, which is the equivalent of the cave. So here people are sitting chained in a cave looking at a wall on which are projected reflections of images. So you have people walking on a parapet above them with images in front of a fire. So they're not even realities, they're images of reality. And they cast shadows on the cave, and everybody sits in the cave looking at the shadows thinking that that's it. And finally, somebody manages to get free from his chain, obviously Socrates. He goes up and sees the light of day, and is so stunned that there's all that besides what he saw in the cave. And he goes back down to tell his friends, and they're annoyed by his importunities, and so they kill him, which is the fate of Socrates. So the impression you get is Socrates became illuminated, he became enlightened, he saw the essences, he was famous for going into trance states, a couple of them are mentioned. Most famous one is when he's about to go into the symposium, where they have this long dinner discussion about love, and he's about to go in and he's on the porch of the home of the host, and he goes out. And he's invited just on the cuff because he's run into him on the way, Aristodemus of Side Athenaeum, who always went around barefooted. And he's a humorous disciple of Socrates. He memorizes everything Socrates says, including think for yourself. So he's a kind of figure of fun in Plato. And I mean, yeah, Socrates says, well, come on along, Aristodemus. I'm going to this great banquet, and I'm sure that they'll accommodate you. So they walk up on the porch, and Socrates goes out, and Aristodemus walks in, not knowing exactly what to do. And the host says, where's Socrates? Well, you know, he's out there, and he's gone out, but he'll come in when he comes down. And he's embarrassed because, you know, anyhow, that's how the symposium starts. And then there's another famous example on the battlefield. In snow, they're up to their knees in snow, and Socrates goes into a trance. And I think it's Alcibiades who mentions that. So you have this notion of Socrates communing with the transcendentals, not only in the trance state, but ordinarily. I mean, he was the bearer of them. His being revealed them, his being. I mean, the great thing about Socrates is that it wasn't his teaching, it wasn't his example, it wasn't his bearing, it wasn't the role he played, it was his being. And that's what Plato communed with. He perceived and saw the being of Socrates. And in doing so, he intuited the true, the good, and the beautiful, because Socrates was transparent to them. So that's the basis for my comparing Socrates to Jesus, the Christ. And the comparison, and especially the consequence for the respective cultures, is enormous. And Socrates, it would be a little, jerry-rigged if it weren't for the fact that Socrates was regarded as a savior by four philosophical schools. Why? Because he overcame the anxiety of having to die. That's what he understood philosophy to mean. That's what the love of wisdom is. You meditate on dying, understanding if you're mortal, and realizing the meaning of finitude. So, the comparison is possible. And I'm fully aware of the fact that though Socrates was a savior, he wasn't a messiah. And yeah.
Did Tillich hold Socrates in as high esteem as you do?
Say what?
Did Tillich hold Socrates in as high esteem as you do?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I mean, I just ordered the courage to
yeah.
be.
No, but I got some of this from him. He's got a wonderful essay on Socrates. Brilliant essay. And that's where he talks about the being of Socrates as more than his teaching and his personal example and whatnot.
So he was the embodiment of the courage to be.
Yeah. He's the exemplar of it and became that for, you know, I don't know how long it lasted, but he was the image of the wise man, largely because of the serenity with which he died. And that became inspiring image for subsequent generations. You know, I don't know, it's played out now, but there's, you know, go up to, let's say up to Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard was a great appreciator of Socrates. He wrote his PhD thesis on Socratic irony. And Socrates is written into some of the major writings of Kierkegaard. He had a little difficult time. I kind of picked up the comparison of Socrates and Jesus from Kierkegaard, who wants to keep them separate. Socrates was the teacher. Jesus was the savior. Yeah, they were both. Both were both.
What's your favorite biography of Socrates?
I think there's one by Plutarch.
Oh, is that very readable though?
Oh yeah, those are very. If not, Socrates is a wonderful biography of Alcibiades, which is a wonderful way to get to Socrates, because he was his foremost pupil who rejected him outside of Plato. So the life of Alcibiades is an amazing thing to read, and I know there's the Plutarch life of Alcibiades. So it's best to read the dialogues. I mean, there's the biography, and especially the seventh epistle. Plato wrote a number of epistles, and the so-called seventh epistle is where he makes a complaint. He says, there's this handbook of my thought circulating. I didn't write it. You know, how can anybody boil down what I've had to say and so on and make a handbook out of it? What Plato thought. There's actually a book in English with that title. And he says, you can't get it from a handbook. You can't get it from any, you know, system of sentences or propositions. It's not reducible to that. You have to be aligned with a teacher like Socrates for some extended period of time. And you have to get what you could call a transmission. And eventually a transmission will occur, and it'll be like a spark jumping to ignite a fire. And it's a tremendous metaphor. And it's obviously what happened to him. So that's what you should read, is start with the apology and any of the major things. Okay, so essence. Have you got it yet? I mean, we're in a realm of ideality. That's a good word for it. Think, if you stumble a little bit on what to abstract to make the necessary abstraction to get to essences, start with geometry. You know, where geometry? That's an ideational issue. That's an issue of ideality. It's all thought forms as far as mathematics. And I didn't kind of get Plato until I realized how critical mathematics is to Plato, as botany is to Aristotle. And that enabled me to distinguish between the two. Aristotle's father was an herbalist. And botany plays a central role because of the actualization of potentialities, namely an acorn into a oak tree. That's critical to Aristotle. And then they say that's how he brought Plato's ideas down from heaven. Well, they never were abstract in that sense for Plato. And that's why I always refer to Socrates as the embodiment of the Platonic ideas. And if you could see through to the being of Socrates, you saw through to the true, the good, and the beautiful. He was transparent to them. And what made him transparent was his confession of self-delusion. Not ignorance. Self-delusion. And that confession made him transparent. And the testimony to it was his daemon, his guardian angel that he makes reference to, who always kept him from doing something he shouldn't do. So it was, you could so call it his conscience. But whenever he was going to do something that was wrong, the daemon would say no. And there was one incredibly important moment about that, when Socrates had an official position within the government. And in order to get him caught up in the regime, they were actually relatives of Plato, the tyrants, who had effected a kind of coup. And to implicate Socrates in the regime, as he was an official, they ordered him to go and arrest a naval admiral who had screwed up a sea battle. But it wasn't, they just used it as an occasion to implicate Socrates. And apparently the guy was going to be executed or whatever. And so they order Socrates to go and arrest him, and Socrates goes home. He doesn't say no, but he acts no. And it was under the pain of death. And my hunch is that that's when Plato went, wow, this guy was willing to die rather than do something wrong that was against his conscience. How can there be such a man who still lives in Athens when everybody is corrupt? Largely because of the consequences of the plague, which was the big event of the Peloponnesian War, when everybody was infected and countless people died, bodies were piled up everywhere, and everyone lost it. So it looks like, to Plato, there's one guy who survived the plague, and it's Socrates. And he can be an example of, what do you call that? Where you esteem somebody, an object of veneration.
Honor?
A veneration, the word I was looking for. And so Plato thought that that was unbelievable, that somebody was alive in Athens who was worthy of veneration. And then what do? They select him out to kill him. And Plato calls that the truest tragedy, that the one man who could have saved Athens from itself was executed by Athens. That's the truest tragedy. So it made Socrates the martyr for subsequent generations because of his standing on his own terms. He's like an early Luther, where he's, here I stand. And it's because of his tumos. That's what did it. Okay, so now how do you distinguish essence from existence? That's the biggie. Now let's go back to Genesis, because that for me is the best model for doing it. I told you there are two creation accounts. One is called P and one is called J. P for priestly, J for Yahwist. Two authors, two respective accounts. One follows upon the other, tells the story over again. And in the first account, human beings are created in the image of God, male and female. Everything is perfect. There's no rupture or problem. Nothing disturbs the perfection of creation. After each day, God looks at it and says it's good. You have the unambiguous affirmation of the goodness of creation. And then the second account. Man, Adam, the word that means both man and dust, is created from the dust of the ground, not in the image of God. And then Eve is created from the rib of Adam. You have a prohibition in the garden not to eat of the tree of good and evil, which if you do, prevents you from access to the tree of life, which overcomes your natural mortality. The second tree in the garden. So the prohibition against eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, better translated as the tree of the knowledge that everything is possible, which induces vertigo, which is the fall. And so the prohibition arouses the desire to transgress it, which happens, and then Adam and Eve are exiled from the garden and cursed. That's existence. So in the first case, you have essence, the essential human being, created in the image of God. That's the metaphor for essential humanhood. You know, any hood is also a platonic essence, like tree hood. That's the form of the tree. That's the essence of the tree. The reason why every acorn goes to an oak is because of the tree hood that's ingredient in the acorn. So the second account is the, okay, the first account is perfect. What else is there to say? You know, let's go home. Well, yeah, we got to tell a story here. So you open it up by virtue of the second account through the prohibition against and the temptation which is acted on and the exile and curse. Okay, so does that then kind of open the gates of the Garden of Eden into historical existence? Yeah, I guess. So the same thing in Greece, but I mean, same kind of pattern. You have the notion of Plato that we have our essential selfhood as human beings, and this is understood as the kind of planetary existence. You know, he talks about we were stars. And we were like cosmic entities, and then the stars were pulverized, and we became stardust on Earth and formed into human beings in our existence. And so he takes in a kind of Orphic myth that our essential self has fallen from the cosmic region onto Earth, into existence, and the prison of this body. And it's a pun on soma sema. The Greek word for body is soma, and the word for prison is sema. So in the course of our lives, we inhabit this body prison, wanting to escape it, which we finally do when we die. So you have the existential predicament, having fallen from our essential humanhood. And then in the Old Testament, or the Bible, you have our, you got to take the notion of our essential self as the law of ourselves, which is posed against us and judges us in our existence. And we're considered guilty accordingly. Why? Well, because you transgressed the prohibition. So it's really, you gotta spend a lot of time trying to think through that one as far as freedom and destiny and necessity and fate. What's that all about? Well, it's an effort to kind of give expression to what act occurred that, in a way, presupposes itself. You can't derive it from anything. You can say, well, you're not to eat the apple. That's just an occasion. Same with the serpent. It's an image to trigger the arousal of desire. So, anyhow, the myth of the fall and the Genesis is an amazing thing to meditate on. The best account I've read is by Paul Ricoeur in a book called The Symbolism of Evil, one of my favorite books of all time. And he gives you a kind of course in the humanities starting with the early Greeks, all around the thematic of the symbolism of evil. And he does a really incredible job of interpreting the biblical account and comparing it to comparable myths in the Greek side. So do you get that? Essence and existence. Essence is what we've come from, what we've fallen from. We have some kind of a memory of it.
Ricoeur.
Yeah, R-I-C-O-E-U-R.
Yeah.
He was a friend of mine. He was one of the famous philosophers of France. I met him at Harvard Divinity School in the 60s, and he came and stayed with us, and I invited him here, and he came here and taught. And I edited his Freud and Philosophy, which is partly why I put that excerpt in your reader. And it's one of the best books on Freud. And so his Symbolism of Evil is, I think, his best book. It's a terrific study. So it's kind of lays, you know, in the consciousness all through the history of philosophy. And then erupts with existentialism in the early part of the 19th century, right coordinate with the artificial synthesis of urea and the founding of the physicalist society and the blood oath and the emergence of industrial society, which transforms human beings into tools in the system of production and consumption. And that's what existentialism protests against. So what happens to existence in industrial society? You grind it up. And so it's okay, so look at the etymology of the word existence. Ex istere. It means to stand out from. So you could say, well, it means to stand out from your essential humanhood, okay? And so then you got to kind of juxtapose like that. But it also means to stand out from nothing. So you got to get into meditation on being a non-being and why existence is our standing out from nothing with our birth until our death. And that gets hard. You know, about the only clue I ever thought was really helpful was to practice Zen Buddhism a little bit and get into the idea that nothing in Zen Buddhism was no thingness. Oh, okay. This nothing as I can't even imagine it. It's the disappearance of thinghood. You know, there's no thingness in Buddhism. That's what you meditate upon in clearing your mind. So the Greeks, yeah, just struggled with that. I mean, it had something to do with the Greek language, I'm sure, because it's perfectly appropriate for discussing such issues as being and non-being. And it's one of the great dialogues of Plato called the Parmenides, where Socrates carries on a discussion with the old Parmenides, who is the Greek who discovered being in his chariot ride to it. And that's one of the strangest moments in Greek thought, that this guy writes a poem about the chariot ride he took. Take that as a matter of ecstatic self-transcendence. And he's carried as far as his tumas could desire. I love that line. As if longing for what is it carries him in this ride. And he goes to the gates of night and day. It was a cosmic center, and the chariot passes through these gates, and a goddess greets him, O youth, and receives him from the chariot, and it's the goddess Alethea. She isn't identified, but it's clearly her, the goddess of truth. And she goes, look, and he goes, it is. It's usually translated it is, but it almost loses the force of the exclamation, you know, it's is, and it cannot not be. So it's the unambiguous affirmation of being on the part of Parmenides. And he says, you can't gainsay it. It cannot not be. And that's think of that as a kind of beginning of logic. So anyhow, you get this vision of being, and you got to just live with it. You can't quite know what to make of it is. That's why all the philosophers in the country laughed when Bill Clinton said it depends on what you mean by is. Do you guys know that line?
Depends what the meaning of is.
Mm-hmm. That had to do with whether sex is only coital, you know, because he hadn't had that kind of sex with Monica. So what is
so it was
sex?
During the impeachment.
That just was a real funny moment, but let me tell you about it. So anyhow, he was famous for making this kind of odd, oblique reference to a philosophical proposition about what do you mean by is. So, I had a hard time, I told you. I took a course in metaphysics in college and I never could understand what being meant because I couldn't make the abstract leap. I had to make a leap in being to get the being. And it took a long time. I'll tell you a strange experience. And I still don't quite know what it meant, but it was an experience that I'll never forget. One of the most profound experiences of my life. I finally got to go to Greece because my granddaughter was at the Kirby School here in Santa Cruz, and her sophomore class was going to go to Greece. So I said, well, could I go along as an unofficial tutor? I'll pay my own way. I had never been to Greece, and I thought, this is my one chance. So I went. And we go to Delphi, and one of the greatest Greek sculptings is called the Charioteer of Delphi. And it's photographic. I mean, I was only aware of it, you know, in terms of pictures and books. And it's exquisite. I mean, here's a guy standing. I mean, he's so glorious in his form. And he's holding the reins. And you know, there's nothing else. It's just the reins, and it's all in bronze. The reins are bronze. And they just kind of cascade off his hand, about this long. And he's a charioteer. So I go to Delphi, and they have a museum at Delphi. You know, that was the site of the famous Delphic Oracle. And who, when asked, who is the wisest of men, said Socrates, of course, because he confesses his self-delusion. And so I walk into the museum. It's a fairly small museum, and they have one gallery devoted to the charioteer. And when I looked upon the charioteer, I burst into sobs. And it was such a kind of fit that I had to cover my face with my hands because there were people around. I didn't know what had happened to me, that this sculpting had seized me so and affected me so emotionally that I stood there and wept and had to kind of wait for it to subside before I could recover my composure. And then I was real proud of myself. I thought, wow, what a wonderful way to respond to a work of art. I never wept or sobbed in a gallery before over anything, and I've seen great works of art. This one got to me. So I thought, okay, I need to celebrate this somehow. So I stepped up in front of the sculpting, and there were about 20 people in the gallery, and I said, I'd like to say a few words about the Charioteer of Delphi, and they all kind of went, yeah, who the hell are you? And so I gave a little talk about the chariot ride that Telemachus took in search of news about his father, Odysseus, and then the chariot ride of Parmenides to the vision of being, and then the chariot ride that Plato talks about that we take between death and our new birth when we pass, and we pass the mysteries, the true, the good, and the beautiful. And if our horses aren't aligned, we are distracted and we don't get the glimpse. And so we got to repeat the thing again. Okay. thank you very much. Had a bad experience. You know, but I'd like to say that it was a moment of communing with being, even though I don't know why I had to cry about it. So that was an amazing experience. Okay, so you have existentialism, just fitting historically, like I couldn't believe when it finally dawned on me that it was the chief mourner for defeated vitalism. 1828, and then you jump to the death of Goethe, which is maybe 1832, and then the birth of existentialism and the Berlin lectures of Schelling, 1841.
42. Erning?
Huh?
Erning?
Erning what?
Schelling.
Schelling?
He thought you said the word Berlin.
The name of the lectures he wants to know. He wants to know the name of the lecture.
Oh, the Berlin lecture.
Berlin.
Oh, okay.
In Berlin. So we're still in the site of the Physicalist Society, which started right about then, practically to the year. And it was an effort to, consolidate the gains of the whole physicalist trend coming from Galileo. Reducing everything to matter is the combination of physical and chemical forces. That's all that matters. And so you have a protest against that and the emergence of industrial society. My teacher, Tillich, was one of the few that really named it as that. The notion of protesting against industrial society, I don't think is particularly clear in the literature. They just take kind of existentialism as a movement of thought that happens as far as the quandary of existence is concerned. That was clear. But its juxtaposition to industrial society, which makes existence a problem. What does it mean to exist in industrial society? And how do we find ourselves in it? That's the issue. We become a problem to ourselves.
It also seems to remind me of the Trans-Pacific Partnership and the Transatlantic Investment, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership are two of the bills that would try to establish a corporate governance, which almost seems to like reach so high on corporate hegemony, trying to reach the highest moment of industrial society, corporatism, with Bilderberg Group, going on for 60 years. And thanks to the growing heated activism against Bilderberg and corporatism, couldn't there be like a slow reemergence of vitalism thanks to the technologies we use, like the internet?
Yeah, we see the emergence is with the entire organic movement. That's where it's clearly expressed. And the turn against the synthetic artificial application of chemicals to food production.
Yeah.
So that's clear. But what you say about corporate empires and the rise of bureaucracy, that's clearly a corollary to industrial society.
What was his reference to Bilderberg? What's Bilderberg?
Bilderberg is based on a secret meetings on top elites on how they want to shape the world. One of them is definitely trying to support the industrial giants like oil, maintaining hegemony of oil.
Have you heard of Bilderberg before? Mm-hmm.
No. Yeah, they got on the map when they had all the anti-globalization.
So it's relatively recent.
Protests in Washington. Mm-hmm. They're one of the groups that they target, along with the G8.
Oh, okay.
And how do you spell it?
Bilderberg.
Bilderberg.
I think it's been around for a while, but didn't start.
Huh.
Yeah. Press.
See, it's reminiscent of Danny Sheehan exposing the corporate conspiracy over the entire last century that focuses, at least in some clear part, with the Dulles brothers, John Foster Dulles and Alan Dulles. John Foster was Secretary of
State.
Foreign Relations, or?
State.
Secretary of State, yes. And his brother was head of the CIA. And they were tied up with corporate interests in terms of banking and legal. There were two major centers.
Brown Brothers Herman, I think, was one of them.
There it is. And they run a conspiracy, you know, to foment wars of liberation like in the world. And they overthrow Mossadegh and the guy in Chile and yada, yada, yada. So anyhow, that's all clear as a corporate conspiracy to control the world. And they had a world domination plan based on American exceptionalism. And the Bushes were totally involved with all that and then gave expression to it in their presidency. So that's all part of this whole industrial society hegemony, is the word, John.
Hegemony.
H-E-G-E-M-O-N-I. I first learned that here. I went to visit the History of Consciousness program just for the hell of it about, I don't know, 8 years ago. I taught it. So I just want to see what was happening with it. So I went up there and listened to somebody give a talk, and the first graduate student to raise his hand, he had a bow tie on, he smoked a pipe, and I thought, this guy's perfect. Had a tweed jacket. And he used the word hegemony in his question, and it just kind of light went on. It's the first time I'd heard anybody say it. I thought, oh, the new buzzword, hegemony.
Hegemony.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... It's like I was and pronouncing it differently.
Corporate tyranny.
So this is a direct line from Dulles to the neocons, Wolfowitz, and,
yeah, all of,
and
all part of it.
And all those guys.
Yep. And so I heard Danny detail all this in his last talk on the assassination of John F. Kennedy. And within a week, a book came out on the brothers, Alan and John Foster. And the subtitle is their secret war to rule the world. I mean, it was a complete illustrated exposition of what Danny had set forth. So that was interesting to get as a confirmation.
Well, if I can just get you back on track for a moment with a question about how existentialism fits in and its timing, you know, when it actually gets formulated. It seems like you're saying, this is a question, you're saying that existentialism comes along to mourn the death of vitalism, which happens around the time of the industrial society. So are you saying, therefore, that existentialism is a philosophical response to industrial society?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. B, I'd like to ask, if existentialism comes along when it does, and I'm assuming existentialism is, even though I do realize that there is a more a secular, atheistic type of existentialism, say, personified in Sartre, and a more religious kind of existentialism, maybe personified in, Kierkegaard. And
yeah, Kierkegaard.
Okay, so would I be right in assuming that existentialism is a philosophical movement and not a theological one?
Yeah.
Okay. Then my question.
But then you don't rule out theology. I mean, okay. There's as much theology in Kierkegaard as there is.
Right, but as a movement, it starts. It is a kind of a secular philosophical movement as opposed to theology.
Right.
Even though it has theology in it or implies theology.
Right.
So then my question is, why, if according to this second myth in Genesis that we are made of dust and there's this prohibition that's violated, and therefore the fall, and you have the myth of the fall of man. Why didn't theology deal with this question? You said it's really something to mull over. You would think that just that, theology would deal with this question. Why did it have to wait till existentialism came along, or was it the fact the factor of industrialism having something inherently to do with that myth.
No, theology always meditated on the doctrine of sin, which is consequent to the fall. So you've got that as an existential reflection deeply embedded in theology. So, but it you know, existentialism took off on its own, albeit with Kierkegaard, who was, you know, for my money, a religious thinker. He wasn't technically a theologian, but he was conversant with theology, and he was a profound philosopher, made the greatest critique of Hegel that anyone has made, demolished Hegel, in effect, who was the most prominent philosopher of the time. And so Kierkegaard is a kind of variant of Marx. Marx also went up against Hegel and was an existentialist in a lot of his themes. So they're interesting to compare in the reaction to Hegel and the response to industrial society. You don't get that response in Kierkegaard. What Kierkegaard went up against was the Christian church. He went up against state Lutheranism in Denmark and wanted to know, how could you be a Christian in a, where you're one by virtue of your birth? You never get to make a decision about it. And so he was the great critic of Christendom as it became institutionalized in the Danish church. And so he carries on the Lutheran protest against religion in its distorted form, and is devastating in his critique. So existentialism is really some, you know, there was a, you might ask, why was it called, well, in fact, there was, philosophy of life. Leibniz's philosophy was contemporary with existentialism, and the foremost figures in that were Nietzsche and Max Scheler, and there were a couple of guys, I suppose Bergson could be, he was the great neo-vitalist philosopher in France, and you could label him as a figure within the movement of the philosophy of life. And so you had that as a counterpart to existentialism. It just didn't expand and have as much influence as existentialism per se. So you begin with Kierkegaard in his attending the lectures of Schelling, and then you get the Kierkegaardian authorship, which is practically as awesome as the Platonic. I don't know, I was going to try to look up how many volumes of Kierkegaard have been published, and it's probably something like, I don't know, oh, maybe I should say 100, but it probably goes beyond that. And he died when he was 42. So it's just stupefying that he had such an output. And at the end of his life, he had an intuition or a premonition that he was going to die at an early age. He wrote an essay called My Point of View as an Author. And he tells you how he set about to project this authorship, how he executed it, how it was organized, and how you should read it. So it's the perfect place to start if you want to study Kierkegaard at all, because it's a study guide. And he says, you know, I wrote all these incidental, occasional pieces, there's a lot of that, but I had a main thematic. And one was what I call the pseudonymous writing, where I affect the mentality of a fictitious person and write in his name. So it's not by me, it's by him. And so it's like he was an actor who wanted to assume roles and the mentalities of the given role. An example would be one essay he wrote called Fear and Trembling, which is about Abraham sacrificing Isaac. And he assumes the mentality of a neo-Kantian ethicist. Kant was the most important philosopher of Europe prior to Hegel, and had an enormous influence, especially with his ethics. He was the formulator of the categorical imperative. And so you have a typical Kantian questioning, how could God ask Abraham to murder his son? What is going on there? And if you don't catch the pseudonym as a typical Kantian, you might mistakenly think that this is what Kierkegaard thinks. Well, it's not what he thinks. It's what this guy thinks. And you've got to kind of qualify everything you respond to in reading about it and reading the text as by this pseudonym. And then you have any number of other pseudonyms that write. They're not exactly fictitious texts, but they're texts by a fictitiously assumed personality. It's so clever and so amazing, and it complicates the interpretive approach to Kierkegaard like you can't believe. And then to add insult to injury, he was engaged to a woman named Regina. She was about 16 years old. She was very young. And he finally realizes that he is suffering from the burden of a Christian consciousness that has actually come almost to its terminal point in him, that it's insupportable, and that he cannot impose this on this young woman by marrying her. And so he breaks off the engagement. And it's a kind of classic case in what's called the
fear of commitment.
Yeah, but you got that right. But it's done for a purpose. Namely, you find obstacles to satisfying yourself in a relationship in order to swell your libido to its height. And that becomes a fuel for your creative powers.
Could I see those two labels, the green and the brown vials?
Yeah. So there's a wonderful book called The Choir of Muses, where Etienne Chilson, the guy I told you about who wrote Being and Some Philosophers, discusses this. So he takes historic cases. One of them is Dante and Beatrice. Dante sees Beatrice on the steps of a cathedral, you know, like this. And he falls in love with this glimpse of this woman, and she becomes his muse. And I don't think he ever said hello to her. So that's a wonderful example of transposing a moment and a potential love affair where you fall in love to a kind of transcendent position where the woman becomes the occasion for your inspiration. And so that's what Regina became for Kierkegaard, and he writes her in between the lines of everything he writes. There's like a hidden subtext about Regina, and it just spread through everything. And so Abraham's sacrifice of Isaac is Kierkegaard's sacrifice of Regina.
So was Regina some pretty precocious, miraculous young thing?
Yeah.
Or just Kierkegaard in his mind made her that?
There is the question.
Yeah, no, she was Danish, so I'd take the former. I mean, I'm half Scandinavian, so she was probably a real deal. But anyhow, she gets married, and that's the end of that, and he suffers from having done that for the rest of his life. And it becomes a motif in what he writes.
Just Damon wouldn't let him do it.
No. I mean, he is, for me, the exemplar of the burden of Christian consciousness. And it, you know, in a way, it comes to end with him. And from then on, you move into fairly strictly secular stuff, except for existentialism, which is this big protest against industrial society and the lament of existence in it. So that's not too evident in Kierkegaard. So you have these pseudonymous writings on the one hand, and then you have his religious writings on the other hand. And they kind of match up. He calls them edifying discourses. They're very difficult to read. Consider the lilies of the field. They neither toil nor spin. But Solomon, all his array, was not as one of those. That's one meditation, one edifying discourse. And they're lovely. They're like, they're almost musical in their literary effect. He was one of the great literary figures within Western culture that I know of. I mean, he asked for permission to do his PhD thesis in Danish. It was required that you write it in Latin. And he got an exemption so that he could write it in Danish, and then he still had to defend it in Latin. Yeah, it's just an example of how much he loved the Danish language and how he became a master of it. There's nobody that can match him as far as Danish is concerned. So that's Kierkegaard. And he's a favorite of mine because I came out of that whole tradition in terms of Lutheranism, and my teacher, Hong, was the translator along with his wife. And Tillich made more out of Schelling than Kierkegaard because he was German and he was a major student of Schelling's, even though Schelling was dead. But he read everything and was enormously influenced by it. Schelling is extremely difficult, and much of Schelling hasn't even been translated into English. So then you get a kind of a hiatus from Kierkegaard to the early part of the 20th century, when Kierkegaard is rediscovered, largely by German thinkers and then to some extent French. Existentialism doesn't take root in Great Britain at all. That's a real interesting anomaly of British culture. It's too conventional, it's too conformist. The whole protest against industrial society, which of course was terrible in Great Britain as far as the industrial towns were concerned. You had Dickens, you know, and novelists who play the part of the protest, but you don't have any contribution to existentialism in Great Britain. It comes out of Germany and France and a little bit Italy. So it's Heidegger then who picks up the thread and becomes the major contributor to existentialism and really does the entire meditation on the cancellation of being. Once being is gone, you've lost the ground of existence. So what do you do with existence that's groundless, having canceled being? And that's what makes for rootlessness and dispossession, in effect, and alienation and estrangement. And Heidegger is more the one who laments the loss of the meaning of being as the background for the quandary of existence than a protest against industrial society. And the unfortunate tragedy of Heidegger is that he picked up with Hitler and thought Hitler was going to be the savior of Germany and he was going to be Hitler's philosopher. No! Not that! Martin! You want to be Hitler's philosopher?
Segal.
And he was a member of the SS, and they all kind of, everybody looked away in complete dismay for maybe 30 or 40 years after the war. And then finally, some guy exposed it and wrote about it, and then the whole sorry relationship of Heidegger to Hitler came out. I mean, he finally broke off, but the Nazis said, you know, we think you're so turgid that we don't want you around here anymore. We can't talk about cancellation of being and blah, blah, blah. I mean, Heidegger's extremely difficult to understand, so I think they got kind of tired of him. And so...
Really? Nazis were tired of being?
Yeah. They got tired of Heidegger.
By the way, for those interested, there's a movie based on the life of Hannah Arendt out on DVD.
Right.
Have you seen it, Paul?
No.
It's really well done.
Yeah.
Especially the movie is worth the scene where after World War II, Hannah Arendt finally meets her professor, because Heidegger was her professor, in the forest, and asks him point blank, why did you do it, and why haven't you apologized?
He didn't answer.
And yeah, there's a great scene between the two.
He had a famous student. He had a number of famous students. Hans Jonas was one of them, the guy I'm so enamored of. But Hannah Arendt, who became the prominent woman philosopher of the 20th
great
century.
Great book, The Origins of Totalitarianism.
Right, that's one of her great things. She covered the Eichmann trial, which was a huge cause celeb. And so anyhow, she was his student and they had an affair. So here's this Nazi sympathizer having an affair with a Jewish student. Yay. And they kept that under wraps until late into the last century when it finally came out also. So Heidegger is a real interesting figure. I almost don't want to recommend him because it's just such a exercise in, you know, difficult reading. I've learned a lot from Heidegger. There's one book on Parmenides. It's called Parmenides that he wrote. And he discusses the myth of Ur at the end of Plato's Republic, which I cherished. I mean, it's a superb commentary on the myth of Ur. So there's those kinds of things in Heidegger that I like. He wrote a book called Kant and the Problem of Metaphysics, in which he discusses the Kantian recoil. I think I mentioned in my book, this is a real swishy one. He talks about how Kant recoiled from the somehow the root of the transcendental imagination. I mean, I kind of almost can't even remember what it's about. And so I just thought, oh, I get it. There's a problem with existence in Kant. I hardly knew anything about the transcendental imagination, but that comes out in the third critique of Kant. So that the problem of existence is already set up with Kant. Well, I knew that Kant had argued that existence is not a predicate. So are you guys ready for this one?
Go ahead.
It's like piling it up, folks. Existence is not a predicate. This was Kant's effort to undermine arguments for the existence of God, which he thought was the human mind overreaching itself. He was real interested in reason within the thinking things within the limits of reason alone. So he was the preeminent rationalist. And so he took on arguments for the existence of God as, you know, going beyond or betraying rationalism. It was beyond the limits of what reason can think. And so he destroyed them by saying existence is not a predicate, therefore it doesn't mean anything to argue on behalf of the existence of God. Why is it a predicate? Well, because it's already assumed in anything you think. If you say this table exists, you've already assumed the existence of the table in saying the table. So why do you add existence to it? Doesn't mean anything.
You don't have to say this table exists, you just have to say, as soon as you say table, it implies it exists.
You might as well say the table tables.
Okay.
Now, I still don't get it. This is a big issue.
But it's the table's a lot better than.
Yeah, really?
Yeah.
But this demolished the arguments for the existence of God.
From St. Thomas Aquinas?
It overthrew it. So it overthrew the whole theological tradition where there were famous arguments like Anselm. You know, God is greater than which nothing greater can be thought. That's called the ontological argument for the existence of God. God is than which nothing greater can be thought. So whatever you try to think above it, it's still God. You know, I mean, it's a clever argument. And so, anyhow, Kant says existence is not a predicate. No? Well, then what happens to the word existence? See, and then you could say, well, that then also became the fate of being. Why not say being is not a predicate if existence isn't? Why do you have to say the table is? And so that never became a big issue coming off of Kant, but it does make sense for me. That once you cancel the word existence logically by saying it's not a predicate, doesn't add anything conceptually to what you've already assumed. Could say the same thing about being. Okay, so that was a big relief for philosophers because they didn't want to bother with God. You know, that we can be atheists now in a secular society and not worry about the existence of God because it's not an issue. And anyhow, doesn't existence imply the conditions of time and space? So why would you apply that to God in any event? You could say God is. That makes more sense than saying God exists. If you want to get away from a being, you know, a person, God isn't a person or a being, even the highest being. So you want to elevate God beyond, you know, subject predicate, subject object relationships. God is not subject to those. He transcends them, and that's what makes him God. Okay. So, listen to this one. Kant recoiled against the unknown root of the transcendental imagination. So I pick up this metaphor of the unknown root. And did that have anything to do with his saying that existence is not a predicate? And why wouldn't that make existence a quandary for subsequent generations, with or without industrial society? What is this unknown root? And isn't that just the predicament we find ourselves in, as far as being uprooted and alienated and estranged? Made perfect sense to me. So here I am teaching here and teaching philosophy of religion. I did one course actually on the arguments for the existence of God, where we did it for a whole quarter. And so one day, 1970, I'm walking in the corridor of Crown College and pass a colleague named, he was a mathematician. And at that time, I was going to try to do a journal for the history of consciousness. I was going to call it Dumas, the Journal of the History of Consciousness. I'm going to make Dumas the center of consciousness, just like Plato did, the middle ground. And so I set about doing that. And so this Jay Greenberg, he stops me in the hall and he says, you know about Gödel, G-O-D-E-L with an umlaut? Well, you know, you don't want to say no if it's a colleague asking you a question about academics. I kind of temporized and went, well, he said, you know, he's the most prominent mathematical logician in the world today, and he's just formulated an argument for the existence of God. Really? Yeah. He said, you ought to find out about it. I thought, oh man, what if I got it from Gödel to put in the first issue of Dumas? I'd get tenure. It would save my ass to have an argument for the existence of God, wouldn't it? Doesn't that obviously follow logically? So I wrote to Gödel. Said, I'm the editor of the journal. I understand you're going to prove it. Would you please send me the proof? And of course, you realize this has overcome Kant, who said you can't. So I get a letter from Gödel, which in itself was a thrill. And he said it was incomplete. Now, the joke is that he was famous for the incompleteness theorems and the undecidability problem. And the incompleteness theorem was that every mathematical set has something incomplete about it that you can't decide. And it became one of the biggest breakthroughs in mathematics of the last century. Incompleteness and undecidability in mathematics. And the implication was, you're trying to say that mathematics is inconsistent? That's like putting a gun to your head if you're a mathematician. So he was hugely important. He winds up at Princeton with Einstein, and they became great colleagues and friends. And after Einstein retired, he went back to the Institute every day in order to walk home with Gödel. Those are conversations I would have loved to have monitored. So the proof is incomplete. So it's like waiting for Gerda. And everybody laughed at me again. So I have occasion to go to New York, and a friend of mine is going to go to Princeton. She was a wonderful photographer. And I go, hey, Adelaide, you ought to go and take a photo of Gödel. He's the most important mathematical logician in the world, and it'd be a terrific coup to get a photo of Gödel. She said, okay, set it up. You got to call him. Really? So I call the Institute. Professor Girl, yes. Oh, this is Professor Lee, remember I wrote it to me, yes. Oh, and he had written to me, when he wrote back, he said, besides, what does... Something like, what does philosophy have to do with consciousness? You know, in terms of the history of what? What is this? What does a logical proof have to do with the history of consciousness? So I tried to talk to him about, a little bit about that, and you could hear he didn't get it. He was writing a logical proof. He didn't have much of an interest in what it meant historically, or how it related to Kant, or whether or not existence is a predicate. He was working out a logical proof, which, by the way, nobody understands, but I thought that was, that means it's perfect, you know, that means it really is a proof if nobody understands it. So anyhow, I said, can my friend come and take a picture of you? No. Why? I have two perfectly good pictures of myself. I go, okay. And it's funny because one of them is by a very famous photographer, Arnold Newman, of Gödel sitting by a nearly erased blackboard. I mean, it's one of the great photographs of any academic of the last century. That was one of the two. Okay, where does that leave us? Well, it leaves us with one tag end. I don't know if I want to say any more about existentialism. We can pursue that, but I haven't told you about logical positivism, the school out of which Gödel came. And it was the Vienna Circle. And it's the fulfillment of what started with the Physicalist Society in Berlin. And it almost makes my whole story look like a comic opera. You know, from Galileo straight on through the reduction of everything to matter, and matter's all that matters, and the Physicalist Society after the synthesis of urea, and now we go to Vienna with the school of logical positivism known as the Vienna Circle, which announces itself as the philosophy of physicalism. And it's under the auspices of Rudolf Carnap, C-A-R-N-A-P, and a colleague of his writes the manifesto of the school. It's a 3-4 page statement of the philosophy of physicalism. I should have put it in your reader. I don't think I got around to doing it, because it's critical. It's even better than the physicalist oath taken in blood. It, at least it stands right there as a signpost for the whole significance of logical positivism. So what their slogan was, the elimination of metaphysics. It's flat out, that's what they state. We're going to get rid of it. We don't like it. It just muddies things up. We're going to disperse that fog. And in doing so, we're going to get rid of aesthetic language, as well as metaphysics or ontology. So the language of being isn't any clearer than the language regarding beauty or art. We're going to get rid of ethical language, because nobody can make their way there, you know, like who's to say what's right or wrong. And religious language. Are you kidding? That's gone too. Well, what's left? Well, first of all, when you get rid of theses devoid of sense that are technically, logically, nonsense, what you have left are empirical propositions that are confirmable largely through experimental laboratory work. The language of science, that's what's left. And that's all that counts for knowledge. So it's a kind of complete fulfillment of what Galileo began with, his notion of secondary qualities, where the human being is removed from the equation in favor of mathematics, which goes to mathematical physics as the primary science that counts for knowledge, and everything is subsumed from there. So this is so clearly formulated by the logical positive school, and Wittgenstein is one of the most famous offshoots of the school. He departed from them. He was famous for saying, philosophy is the disease of which it should be the cure. One of the cleverest things said, and I'm sure he means them. So he got jaundiced, I think. And he wanted to get over this ideological grudge of physicalism in working out his own philosophical point of view. Philosophy is the disease of which it should be the cure. It just, that to me wipes them off the map. But they were extraordinarily effective and influential, especially in Great Britain and in this country, not so much in Germany or France, which kind of held out with more humane considerations for philosophy. So there it is, as far as the history of the tradition and what one is up against in terms of who takes charge. This is the good use of the word hegemony, and determining what counts for knowledge. And, you know, I think if you did a close analytic survey of this campus, it would confirm the kind of trend I'm talking about and how it's come to prominence here in the natural sciences, and who calls the shots, and where, you know, follow the money.
Do you think physicalism really took off because it unlocks and exposes the potential for energy use from just nature itself, so we can see it being a yield of profit? Do you think that's why it became so popular? Because physicalism really gives the ground for the capitalist system, because it can reduce anything to a profit or surplus value use.
And it also seems to be another way to finally form the idea, finally secure elitism.
Well, see, that elitism is a real tricky term, because we're all members of elites. I mean, this class is an elite. So, you know, kind of any, you know, initiated group is an elite. So I've always kind of balked at using the word elite in a negative way, because it's pervasive throughout the culture. You have elites that are more powerful than other elites, so you get into a, you know, a critique of elites. But I'm not so sure that cuts any ice, John.
Okay. Because
when you think about it, because, you know, you go to the university, you're a member of an elite, you don't think of yourself that way, but it's clearly the case.
We're at the heart of the empire.
Yeah. So any particular interest power group that you get involved with is technically an elite, sociologically an elite. Yeah.
It does seem like humanity is included in the reduction.
No, it's excluded.
As nature is.
Yeah.
And especially workers who are just cogs in the wheel.
That's the
like.
Outcome. That's why you get the protest against it. I mean, it's amazing that there was a protest mounted. It's almost a spasm. It's almost more of an outcry than anything you can formulate conceptually. That's what existentialism is. It's an outcry. And that's why it's pervasive in the arts, in literature, in the fine arts, in theater. I mean, you have existentialist themes that are extremely prominent. I mean, take Death of a Salesman. That had a huge impact on me. I saw the play in 1952 when I was a student at St. Olaf in Minneapolis, starring, who would have been?
Steiger.
Little,
was it Steiger?
No, Thomas Mitchell. And he was perfect. I mean, he was the best, I think, whoever has played Willie Loman. And I went alone, had a third row seat, had written to the theater before and said, I'm a interested college student, you take an interest in me and you give me a third row seat. And they went, okay. Something like that. And, I mean, there it was, you know. He wasn't Willie Loman as a human being. He was a salesman. And he had actually sacrificed his humanity to a salesman. And that's the theme. It's such a strong existentialist theme in the play that here's a guy who doesn't have a soul. He's completely empty as far as his spiritual life is concerned because he's nothing but a salesman. And now he's ended up at the end of his career coming home without having made a sale and almost having an auto accident. And everything is running out on him. The refrigerator doesn't work anymore because he's made his last payment. They time those things. And so he tries to commit suicide. And that's a play that had...
I've also seen the film, TV film based on in high school, Death of a Salesman.
I'd urge you guys to, you know, you could get it probably on YouTube. Probably even get Thomas Mitchell. He did a recording of it. And it's incredible to listen to. You don't have to see it. It all gets visualized in your mind. So there are records on it, and I actually had a copy.
Does Teilhard de Chardin, you know, the Christic force, fit into this vitalist, physicalist?
Say that again?
You know, de Chardin, the guy that Danny Sheehan came up with the Christic force, Teilhard?
Chardin.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he was an effort. That was an effort to overcome the whole show.
So he was a...
He's almost
the camp of the vitalists.
Yeah, totally. And he anticipated now, which I can't exposit for you. I wish I could. And I hit on it last summer because I'm still obsessed with this whole business and I keep getting books I want to read. And what floats in, I've already mentioned him to you, but a guy named Galen Strawson who says that physicalism entails panpsychism. Oh, man, where'd you get off of that? And now there's and he publishes in the Journal of the History of Consciousness Studies. And there's a couple books now of reactions to his proposing this. So it's a complete turnaround. So you could say Chardin anticipated that. Namely, the Gaia hypothesis makes a stab at it. How interesting to say that the Earth is alive. And then this guy that did The Secret Life of Plants, you know, the plants are alive, really? That's big discovery.
And also it's like a common trend on the it also seems to be based on discoveries, it's a deeper philosophy to the bizarre notion that I've seen common arguments on environmentalist or anti-pollution, there's no planet B. The simplification of the there's no other alternative planet that we know than Earth as a living organism.
Although you're going to get to go to Mars if you want to, and if you have the money.
One of the scariest thing about anti-vitalism is the example of genetically modified organisms.
Yeah, right.
That's because I was just reading something, there are a lot of organic products that are sold, and I have a list of them, you know, I don't remember where I got it from. And they are selling organic products and trying to oppose those people who want GMO labor.
Yeah.
And it's really interesting. I'm not very familiar with those products, but it's...
And the movement is a lot stronger in Europe. I mean, they've been holding the fort against
it. Yeah.
But Monsanto, for instance, is so strong here that they...
But it's weakening slowly, even now. Vermont and soon to be California... We already tried democratic process and it's had a strong after effect. Now we're going through a state Republican fashion, relying on state legislators, gonna push it all the way.
Yeah.
I have a Facebook friend who must be reading this guy who said that physicalism can make room for panpsychism.
Entails. I love the logical term,
yeah, right.
Entails.
Well, I got an argument with this guy because he said that there's no contradiction between being a vitalist and being a materialist. And in fact, he is both a materialist and a vitalist, and a mechanist. I mean, I asked him about, would you include mechanism, and he said yes. And when I responded to his argument by saying, the only way you can get away with that, because he says, after all, everything is alive. And when I responded by saying, you're reducing the meaning of being what's alive, and therefore you can say this, he didn't get it.
Yeah.
He didn't, because he said, well, if we admit everything's alive like a vitalist, why can't a machine be alive too? That was his argument.
Right. That's that book that I stumbled on called The Vital Machine. And he tries to overcome the physicalist vitalist conflict by talking about using the terminology both ways. And that's his way of overcoming it. It doesn't work as far as what he works out, but it's obviously a trend. And, once you get kind of tired of talking about human beings as machines, you might as well talk about machines as human beings. And that sounds sort of new.
It seems like they want to make people into machines.
It's already happened.
And they want to then create their own artificial intelligence,
yeah,
which will be superior.
Yeah.
It's so
that's where it's
contradictory.
Going. Yep.
Like you said, Paul, existentialism is an outcry, because my favorite, other than the Death of a Salesman, my favorite existentialist play is Ionesco's Rhinoceros, because he definitely deals with dehumanization on a mass scale.